Welcome to our worship for Maundy Thursday. Just before we have our gathering song, I just want to invite you, if you would like to take part in the symbolic hand washing that will be part of this service later on, you might find this time useful to maybe get a bowl, any kind of bowl will do, and some water. And when we come to that point, if you're watching in a household, then you could wash each other's hands as a sign of you serving one another. If you're on your own, you can wash your own hands. But just be aware that Jesus is with you, and perhaps imagine him washing your hands, bringing you refreshment and making you clean. So as we start our service, we're going to remember that it is only by God's love and grace that we can enter his presence. Welcome in the name of Christ. God's grace, mercy, and peace be with you, and also with you. We come in this service to God, in our needs, and bringing with us the needs of the world. We come to God, who has come to us in Jesus, and who walks with us the road of our world's suffering. We come with our faith and with our doubts. We come with our hopes and with our fears. We come as we are, because it is God who invites us to come, and God has promised never to turn us away. We come to the God who in Jesus laid aside his majesty for you and for me.
Our reading this evening is from John chapter 13, verses 1 to 17 and verse 34. It was just before the Passover festival. Jesus knew that the hour had come for him to leave this world and go to the Father. Having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end. The evening meal was in progress, and the devil had already prompted Judas, the son of Simon Iscariot, to betray Jesus. Jesus knew that the Father had put all things under his power, and that he had come from God, and was returning to God. So he got up from the meal, took off his outer clothing, and wrapped the towel round his waist. After that, he poured water into a basin and began to wash his disciples' feet, drying them with the towel that was wrapped around him. He came to Simon Peter, who said to him, "Lord, are you going to wash my feet?" Jesus replied, "You do not realize now what I am doing, but later you will understand." "No," said Peter, "you shall never wash my feet." Jesus answered, "Unless I wash you, you have no part with me." "Then, Lord," Simon Peter replied, "not just my feet, but my hands and my head as well." Jesus answered, "Those who have had a bath need only to wash their feet. Their whole body is clean. And you are clean, though not every one of you." For he knew who was going to betray him, and that was why he said, "Not every one of you was clean." When he had finished washing their feet, he put on his clothes and returned to his place. "Do you understand what I have done for you?" he asked them. "You call me teacher and Lord, and rightly so, for that is what I am. Now that I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also should wash one another's feet. I have set you an example that you should do as I have done for you. Very truly I tell you, no servant is greater than his master, nor is a messenger greater than the one who sent him. Now that you know these things, you will be blessed if you do them. A new command I give you: love one another as I have loved you. So must you love one another. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples, if you love one another." We're going to be singing now Servant King. And as the song plays and as you sing, I encourage you at home to wash your hands, or if you're with someone else, potentially wash one another's hands, just as a sign of remembrance and as a commitment to love one another as he has loved us. Let's sing together.
Chose to bend his heart. to cruel nails, surrender.
This is our God, the servant King. He calls us now to follow Him, to bring our lives as a daily offering, a worship to the servant King.
So let us learn how to serve, and in our lives enthrone Him, each other's needs to prefer.
So after that wonderful song, A Servant King, let's come to a time of prayer. Servant of all. Prince of peace and friend of sinners, we praise you and give you thanks because you laid aside your power as a garment and took upon yourself the form of a slave. You became obedient unto death, even death on a cross. You allowed yourself to be born and die in our place. You allowed your own feet to be anointed for death. You allowed a sinner to wash your feet with her tears, for God chose what is low and despised in the world to bring to nothing things that are. Therefore, with the woman who gave you birth, with the woman who anointed you for death, with the woman who worshipped you with her tears, and with all our fellow sinners, who have loved and served you from that time till now, we praise you, Lord Jesus. Eternal Father, blessed is our brother Jesus, who rose from supper, laid aside his garment, took a towel, poured water, and washed his disciples' feet, saying to them, "If I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also ought to wash one another's feet. If you know these things, blessed are you if you do them." Come now, mighty Spirit of God, wash us and make us one body in Christ, that as we are bound together in this act of love, we may no longer be bondage to the principalities and powers that enslave creation, but may know your liberating peace, such as the world cannot give. Amen.
A reading from Luke chapter 22, verses 17 to 23. When the hour came, Jesus and his apostles reclined at the table, and he said to them, "I have eagerly desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer, for I tell you, I will not eat it again until it finds fulfillment in the kingdom of God." After taking the cup, he gave thanks and said, "Take this and divide it among you. For I tell you, I will not drink again from the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God comes." And he took bread and gave thanks, and he broke it, and he gave it to them, saying, "This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is poured out for you. But the hand of him who is going to betray me is with mine on the table. The Son of Man will go as it has been decreed, but woe to that man who betrays him." They began to question among themselves which one of them it might be who would do this. As we reflect on those disciples gathered round that table, we remember that we too are invited to sit around the table of grace, a table where all are invited, no matter who they are, no matter what they've done or what they haven't done, what they've been or what they've not been. We sing together.
Never ending.
I wonder what you think when you look at the familiar picture of Jesus and his disciples gathering around the table, eating and drinking together at Passover. And I wonder how those feelings connect with our thoughts this evening, as we each sit in our own homes and explore again the events of that night, with Jesus washing his disciples' feet as the demonstration of his servanthood, and as he taught them to break bread and share wine in remembrance of him. For me, it says something about the time that we've come through, and indeed still journeying through. A time when we can't gather with our own families and friends, or even as a church family. A time when we can't gather round a family table and enjoy a meal. A time when we can't come close to others in order to serve them in the way that we would want to. And I know that at this time, when many of us will have not received bread and wine of the Eucharist for almost a year, and for others of us, there have been brief opportunities to partake in these offerings of God's love when the church could be open. But even when we have been able to meet, we've not been able to enjoy that deep fellowship that we're used to. We're used to being able to come to church, to worship, to sing God's praises, to share bread and wine and be family together. And it's true that we often take those familiar things for granted. They become habits and they lose something of their significance until, that is, they're taken away. And I'm sure you, like me, will have heard many people talking about things they will never take for granted again. And I'm sure many of us will have that feeling about our worship, and particularly about the Eucharist, that sacred meal that gives us an experience of the God who holds the past, the present, and the future in his hands. That sacred meal that reminds us that our lives are lived as part of the new creation of God's kingdom, which is a kingdom of love, peace, forgiveness, healing, and joy. It's a sacred meal that brings the whole people of God together from the past and from the present. It's a sacred meal that's open to all. And it's a sacred meal that nourishes us to live our lives for Jesus day by day. But even though the Eucharist is central to our faith, being an instruction that Jesus gave his followers to continue, I'm convinced that God has been gracious to us in the past year and has helped us to develop different ways of being nourished by him, with the space that we've been given to draw near to him, to deepen our prayer life, to read more of the scriptures and other Christian books, and spending more time engaging with his creation, especially in the good weather we had last summer. Now, this might not be a long-term substitute for coming together, but it has sustained us for a time. And even though we've been unable to serve others in the way that we've been used to, and perhaps the way we'd like to, there have been other ways to show our love and care for others. Because one instruction that Jesus gave on that Holy Thursday that we can always do, no matter what, is to love one another. So I guess what's on my mind on this Maundy Thursday, at this point of time, as we're hoping to emerge from the COVID restrictions that have shut our doors and prevented us from sharing the Eucharist and serving one another in the ways that we are used to, reflect something of what Bishop Nick said a while ago. First, It's about reflecting on what we have missed and what we want to get back. And from talking to you all, I know you all want to come to worship, including gathering round the holy table and sharing bread and wine. But I'd also want us to encourage us to reflect on what our coming together and sharing bread really means to us. Perhaps praying that we might experience more of God's love and grace through the sacrament, so we don't just simply fall back into an old habit, but that we begin to experience something new and fresh. And secondly, there's the question about what we may have developed over the past year that have drawn us closer to God and have sustained us, that we might want to hold on to, along with thinking what we can put in place to ensure we don't lose sight of those things as life gets busier and filled with other things as our freedom increases. Because although none of us would ever say that God has made this pandemic happen, I do believe that he will use it for good, to help us to rethink our lives, including our spiritual life, in order that we might be drawn closer to him and be transformed by him into the people he calls us to be. People with a servant heart, to reach out into the world with his love, which is what Jesus was teaching his followers to do as they gathered round that table and shared that last Passover meal. Amen. And so we say together what we believe. We believe in a God who is always with us, who never leaves us alone. We are not alone. We live in God's world. We believe in God who has created and is creating, who has come in Jesus to reconcile and to make all things new. We trust in God who calls us to be the church, to love and to serve others, to seek justice and to resist evil, to proclaim Jesus crucified, dead and buried, our judge and our hope. In life and in death, in life beyond death, God is with us. We are not alone. Thanks be to God.
And so we come to our time of intercession. In the power of the Spirit, let us pray to the Father through Christ, the Saviour of the world. Father, on this, the night he was betrayed, your Son, Jesus Christ, washed his disciples' feet. We commit ourselves to follow his example of love and service. Lord, hear us and humble us. On this night, he prayed for his disciples to be one. We pray for the unity of your church. Lord, hear us and unite us. On this night, he prayed for those who were to believe through his disciples' message. We pray for the mission of your church. Lord, hear us and renew our zeal. On this night, he commanded his disciples to love, but suffered rejection himself. We pray for the rejected and unloved. Lord, hear us and fill us with your love. On this night, he reminded his disciples that if the world hated them, it hated him first. We pray for those who are persecuted for their faith. Lord, hear us and give us your peace. On this night, he accepted the cup of death and looked forward to the new wine of the kingdom. we remember those who have died in the peace of Christ. Lord, hear us, and welcome all your children into paradise. Trusting in the compassion of God, as our Saviour taught us, so we pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Amen. Let's now sing together. My song is Love Unknown.
My song is love unknown. My Savior's love to me, love to the loveless, shown that they might lovely be. Oh, who am I that for my sake my Lord should take frail flesh and die? He came from his blessed throne, salvation to bestow, but such disdain, so few that longed for Christ would know. But oh, my friend indeed, who at my need his life did spend. Sometimes they strew his way, and his sweet praises sing, resounding all the day, hosannas to their King. Then crucify is all their breath, and for his death they thirst and cry. What has my Lord done? What makes this rage and spite? He made the lame to run, he gave the blind their sight. Sweet injuries, yet they had these, themselves displeased and against him rise. Stay and sing. No story so divine. Never was love, dear King, never was grief like thine. This is my friend, in whose sweet presence days could gladly spend.
When the disciples had sung a hymn, they went out to the Mount of Olives. Jesus prayed to the Father, "If it is possible, take this cup of suffering from me." He said to his disciples, "How is it that you are not able to keep watch with me for 1 hour? The hour has come for the Son of Man to be handed over to the power of sinners." Christ was obedient unto death. Go in his peace.